Hello everybody. In this video, we are going to start with the imaging studies, the basics of imaging studies used in medical science. And we'll start with the X-rays, and we'll cover this imaging studies concepts in few subsequent videos, and this will be our layout regarding imaging studies basics. What I have planned is that we are going to go through these different parts, and in the first part the discussion topic would be radiograph or X-rays of various reasons, including the commonest one, the X-ray chest, fluoroscopy and IVU, intravenous urography, followed by the second series, that is ultrasonography, then the computerized tomographic scans, an MRI, magnetic resonance imaging, and followed by mammography, an angiography, and then nuclear scans and other specialized studies will be covered in the seventh part. So you already know this, my mail ID, the web URL, WhatsApp number, Instagram. You can use these links whenever you want. Okay. Let's start with this basic discussion regarding this imaging studies. As we all know, the visible light means with the help of this light, we can see the things around us. And then what about X-rays? I have pointed here this visible light as well as X-rays because when these X-rays were discovered in 1895, Usually the most of the thing that was absorbing visible light, these were the radiation, the X-rays. Surprisingly, they were passing through those materials, the materials absorbing visible light. These radiations, X-rays, they were able to pass through even those materials. But at that time, the nature of these radiations, that was not known. So they named as X-rays. So this mysterious radiation had the ability to pass through many materials that absorb visible light. And hence, these radiations, from then onwards, they are known as X-rays. The discovery of X-rays, few important points regarding this topic, was done by Wilhelm Röntgen. Then on 8th of November 1895, almost 125 or 126 years back. As we all know, these plain radiographs, these X-rays are also known as, or I should say better known as radiographs. These plain radiographs, they are very important in surgical practice also. Just to give you this information, that American College of Radiology, they recommend limiting lifetime diagnostic radiation exposure. I'm again telling this, lifetime diagnostic radiation exposure to 100 millisievert. And just to give you an idea, this 100 millisievert, that is the limiting lifetime diagnostic radiation exposure, is almost roughly equal to around 10,000 chest X-rays. Or in terms of CT chest, up to 25 chest CTs, recommended by American College of Radiology. So remember this, our exposure should be at least less than 100 millisievert throughout the lifespan, right? Okay, it should be less than 100 millisievert, fine. But what is the amount of radiation we are going to get by a single chest X-ray nowadays? A single chest X-ray, it exposes the patient to about 0.1 millisievert. And this 0.1 millisievert, it is the same amount of radiation that usually we get naturally exposed over 10 days. Naturally, we are getting this. Over the time period of 10 days, we are routinely getting 0.1 millisievert radiation. At the same time, a mammogram, it exposes a woman to 0.4 millisievert, almost 4 times of a single chest X-ray. And this 0.4 millisievert is the amount of radiation that a person would expect to get from natural background exposure over 7 weeks. Over 7 weeks, almost, let's say, 2 months. So a mammogram, radiation exposure, naturally anyone can get over a period of 7 weeks, and a single chest X-ray over a period of 10 days. And maximum that limit is 100 millisievert, right? 100 millisievert. In chest X-ray, 0.1 millisievert. In mammogram, 0.4 millisievert, right? Next question is, what is the fatal dose? Means to cause death within hours of exposure to radiation, something more than 10 gyron. Whereas this 4 to 5 gyron radiation exposure will be lethal within 60 days or 2 months. But in the short term, less than 2 gyron will not be lethal. But yes, in the long term, it may cause death in that particular person due to some other secondary cause induced by this radiation. Remember one thing, irrespective of the doses, radiation of any kind, no matter how small it is, it carries a finite risk of neoplasia and other associated disorders. So the take-home message is, whenever required, then only order for a radio diagnostic studies using radiations like X-rays, CTs, angiographies, fluoroscopy, IVU, RGMCU, and so on. So whenever required, then only kindly order it, right? Another very important name, apart from this great fellow, the discoverer of X-ray, the Marie Curie and Pierre Curie. And these two personalities, they were associated with the discovery of radioactivity, right? In 1903, the Pierre Curie and the Marie Curie, they received a Nobel Prize for the radioactivity along with Henri Becquerel, the discoverer of radioactivity, natural radioactivity. And after 1903-1906, Pierre Curie, the husband of Marie Curie, he died in a street accident in Paris. Even after the death of her husband, Marie Curie again received another Nobel Prize in 1911 regarding the discovery of this polonium and radium, the two radioactive elements. It is because of her these two radioactive elements were added into the periodic table, and for that in 1911 she received again another Nobel Prize. Only lady receiving two Nobel Prizes in different subjects, right? And polonium is based on our country of Poland, and the name of radium basically derived from the word ray, R-A-Y, right? And Marie Curie died of aplastic anemia due to excessive radiation exposure in 1934. So idea of telling you these type of history points is that this radiation is dangerous for life whenever it is not cautiously used. So even in hospital setup, be careful whenever you are asking for an imaging study using radiation, right? She died of aplastic anemia in 1934 and likely caused by the prolonged exposure to radiation. And just to tell you that at present also, even her notebooks, they are still radioactive, almost a century later. And today they are stored in lead-lined boxes and will likely to remain radioactive, her notebooks. They're likely to remain radioactive for another 1500 years. Now see the power of radiation. After so much of hard work and so many lives just involved in the research projects of these type of radiation, what we get is a film like this nowadays, a chest radiograph, right? All of you are familiar with this chest radiograph. Now, as far as the radiograph, in this video, we'll focus on the general specific point. Whenever you are asked to read a chest x-ray, what are the important points you would like to tell to the examiner or to the patient, or the information that can be used for the management of that particular patient. So PA chest radiograph, PA means posterior anterior view. This is the mainstay of standard medical examination nowadays. So most commonly this posterior anterior view is used during the examination of chest. Usually in all the admitted patients, this is a routine film on admission. And why this is a routine film? Because it is going to provide a baseline for later comparison of the patient during the treatment or even after the treatment in the post-operative period or during follow-up, right? Later on, during the post-operative period, if the patient is going to develop some pneumonitis patches or some post-operative infections or pulmonary edema or other diseases of affecting the chest or the lung parenchyma or sometimes lung collapse, so this routine film will be a baseline, will act like a baseline for comparative studies during the management of these type of patients. Apart from posterior anterior view, there is another view that is antero-posterior, AP view. AP view is usually not done whenever the patient is unconscious or on ventilatory support. Then only bedside this antero-posterior view can be done and is indicated. It can give us the idea of lung fields. Otherwise, routinely the posterior anterior view is preferred. Lateral projection, sometimes yes, it is required, but usually not done routinely. And when it is required, whenever we want to localize a lesion or a foreign body that is lying inside, for interventional purposes, whenever we want to go for some intervention over that particular patient to localize a lesion or a foreign body, this lateral projection is required along with the PA view, right? And whenever we want to see the structures usually not seen on posterior anterior view, then we can go for lateral projection. And what are the structures that we cannot see on posterior anterior view? The right ventricular border, the left atrial border, the oblique fissure, the posterior costophrenic angles, the spine, and differential diagnosis of mediastinal masses, this lateral projection X-rays can be ordered for. Few important points regarding technically correct chest X-ray. The position is very important and the positioning must be exact. With what are the things that must be there in a chest X-ray? Both left and right costophrenic angles should be visible along with the apex, the apices of the bilateral lungs. These should be visible within the film. And the scapulae, both the sides must not, ideally, must not overlap the bony cage. Or minimal overlapping should be there. Whenever it is not possible, better to not overlap the scapula over the bony cage. Remember this word. Whenever you are reading a chest X-ray for a patient or for your exams, or whenever you want to report to your consultant, remember this word, pair. This pair word comes under image quality of any chest X-ray. P stands for posterior anterior view. We can add here this AP view along with this P, right? Or lateral view. Already discussed, right? Lateral. A is for adequate exposure. I stands for inspiration. The film should be in full inspiration. And R is rotation. Rotation should not be there. Rotation should be nil. Nil means no rotation is required. So if these four important characteristic feature is there in a chest X-ray, we can say, okay, this chest X-ray is perfect or near perfect, right? So remember, pair, PA view, adequate exposure, inspiration, the film should be in full inspiration and with no rotation, right? In PA view, it's a routine view, and posterior anterior view, it basically, it refers to the direction of beam that is coming. The direction of beam is from posterior to anterior. The X-rays are coming from the posterior end of the patient, from the back, and photographic plate is situated anterior to the chest wall, and then this film is being made. This is PA view, and AP view is just opposite of this PA view as far as the direction of beam is concerned. And why PA's view is important for cardiomegaly? Because usually the heart is, you know, almost all the patient, the heart is situated anteriorly, and the film will be as close to the heart as possible in case of posterior anterior view. Whereas in anterior posterior view, the heart will be away from the film. So that's why there is chances of pseudo cardiomegaly in AP view. So take home message, please don't comment over the cardiomegaly part in AP view, chest X-ray, right? Cardiothoracic ratio, accurate estimation can be done over PA view. And what is this cardiothoracic ratio? It is the ratio of the width of cardiac shadow at its widest point to the diameter of the thorax at its widest point. And it should be less than 0.5. Normal cardiothoracic ratio is always less than 0.5, or in percentage we can say less than 50%. P, then A. A is for adequate exposure. It is related to penetration of radiation, and adequate exposure is basically when the thoracic vertebrae, they are just being visible through the heart shadow. And if that is there, just being visible, thoracic vertebrae are just visible, that is known as adequate exposure. Whenever there will be under penetration or underexposure, a white film will be there and useless. This cannot be used. Whereas in overexposed film, That is very black film. Sometimes, yes, if there is no other way, this overexposed film sometimes can be used in bright light, right? Then I, P-A-I, I stands for inspiration. The chest X-ray film should be in full inspiration. The depth of inspiration should be full. And to know that, count the number of reps, preferably on the right side, preferably on the right side. That is seen above the right hemidiaphragm. If 10 posterior reps are present, posterior part of the reps, if 10 counts are present, that is in full inspiration. And along with these 10 posterior reps, if there are more than 10, and there is also presence of flatness of the hemidiaphragm, with a decrease in number and size of the lung markings at that side, that is suggestive of COPD, chronic obstructive pulmonary disease. Finally, the rotation, R for rotation. Rotation with respect to the cassette, the film, and abnormal appearance of the left and right lung fields will be there due to this presence of this rotation, and that's why this rotation is also important, and it should be checked by the angles made by the clavicle with the vertical are the same on each side. If both the angles are same, it means there is no rotation. And how can we see the angles? We are not going to measure it, so we can indirectly measure the distance between this midline and the external end of the clavicle on both the sides. If both the sides the length is that is equal, it means there is no rotation. What usually I do is, whenever we are reading a chest X-ray, there are two methods. Either we can go from outside to inside, or the details can be told from inside to outside. I usually prefer from outside to inside, so as not to miss anything, right? And for that, again, this mnemonic should be remembered. Apart from that, pair will also come under this: A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, I, the first 9 alphabets. And the last one, this I means image quality. And in image quality, we have discussed pair, right? Posterior anterior view, then adequate exposure, then inspiration, full view, and rotation should not be there, pair. And apart from this image quality, then A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H. A stands for assessment of patient data. We must confirm that, yes, that is the patient we are going to take, and this X-ray belongs to this particular patient. There should not be any confusion regarding that. B stands for the body wall. Body wall means the soft tissue surrounding the chest wall, the bony cage. After commenting over the body wall reason, then we'll come to the bony cage, followed by cardiac condition, then diaphragm, related to diaphragm, both the sides, then presence of external tubes and any foreign body. External tubes like Ryle's tube, the endotracheal tube, the intercostal drainage tube, the central venous pressure lines, and sometimes in patients of trauma, some foreign body, or in firearm injury and a bullet, this metallic foreign body, these things must be observed. And F stands for fields of lungs, both the sides. G stands for the great vessels, the arch of aorta and other great vessels. And then H stands for hilum, along with mediastinum. So these are the headings under which we should comment over any particular chest X-ray, right? And here I have just marked few areas, starting from this one, the soft tissue corresponds to soft tissue, the body cage, the body wall, and this second is for bony cage, this one, then followed by the third is related to the diaphragm, the area of diaphragm, this is the diaphragm, this one, and this one, right, this is the diaphragm. And then fourth one is the area of the lung field, black, that black one, both the sides. Then fifth one is for heart, the cardiac shadow, this one. And then sixth one is for the mediastinum, the comment over the mediastinum. In this X-ray, you can see this tube-like structure running from, yes, what is this? Yes, you're right. This is a central line pressure line, that central line, and this was inserted through the right jugular vein, right? Right internal jugular vein, okay? Reaching up to the superior vena cava here. So just to summarize, in the chest, the systematic examination include the first one, the soft tissue shadows, including the breast in case of patients, and muscles, then cutaneous tissues, presence of air in the cutaneous tissues, any foreign body, all these things should be commented upon, presence of hematoma in a trauma patient, then bony cage, including the ribs, the clavicles, the scapulae, the spine, and the proximal humerus, both the sides humerus. Then after the bony cage, then let's come to the diaphragm area and subdiaphragmatic area. Very important for a surgeon. Usually the free gas under right dome of diaphragm is there, and that is suggestive of perforation peritonitis, hollow viscous perforation. There are other causes of also this presence of free gas under domes of diaphragm, including post laparoscopy patient is usually they have free gas under domes of diaphragm. But in a pathological condition without any history of laparoscopy, usually this is suggestive of hollow viscous perforation, right? Then we must comment over the lung field area, followed by the heart and the mediastinum along with hilum. So these are the things we must take care of. And finally, very important thing, always compare bilateral and symmetrical structures whenever you are reading a chest X-ray. So that's all in this video. Thank you. One by one, we'll discuss all the things according to our layout plan. So till then, bye-bye. Take care.